I began playing the violin when I was 9 years old. I was shy. I was backward. I was timid. I was afraid. I was abused. And the violin became my refuge. I could go in my room and shut the door and be practicing. I was away from the chaos, the confusion, the turmoil, and the anger, the confusion of my family. And the violin, the music, watered my imagination so that by the time I was a teenager, I had a dream. A dream to become a professional violinist. A dream to play music the rest of my life. So when I got a music scholarship to college, to Arizona State University, I was thrilled because this seemed like an affirmation to me until I got to college. The first day I had to go see my counselor and I told him of my dream and he said, "Oh no, Arvel. We don't want you to play the violin. We want you to be a school teacher." Well, that's fine. But I hadn't dreamed about growing up to be a school teacher. I had dreamed about growing up to be a violinist and playing music for people like you. So what I heard him say was, "Arvel, you're not good enough. Only the top 5% can ever go on to be professional violinists. And you're just not good enough." Well, if I wasn't good enough, then what was I going to do? I had no backup plan. There was no plan B. So for 2 years, I wasted that scholarship looking for something else I was going to do for the rest of my life. Finally, out of anger and frustration, I went to my professors and I said, "Where would you go this summer to study if you were going to do that?" And two out of three said, "Well, I would go to Illinois and study with Dr. Paul Rowland at the University of Illinois." And so that's what I did. At the end of my second year, I put everything I owned into my Chevy Nova, which wasn't very much. But I said goodbye to my parents in Scottsdale, and I turned that car east, and I began driving. I didn't know how I was going to get there. I didn't know how it was going to happen. I just knew that I had to try it. I had to do it, even if it meant dying while I was trying to do it. That's how much it meant to me. I was reinventing myself. I knew no one there except this teacher, and I'd never met him. No one knew me, and that's the way I wanted to be because I was starting over. I was reinventing myself, and sometimes that's what we have to do. So I was leaving everyone behind. And this man, Dr. Paul Rowland, he took me apart, and he put me back together. And within 1 year, I knew how to play the violin. I just didn't know what music was. But I had taken that leap of faith, and that leap of faith is what this next animal totem is teaching us how to do. I'm talking about the red-tailed hawk. Everyone close your eyes and pretend that you're a juvenile red-tailed hawk. You're sitting on the edge of the nest. You've never flown, but you know it's possible because you see your parents coming and going. You want to very bad, but you spread your wings out and you hold onto the nest very tight. When the wind comes up, you don't let go because you're afraid. You're afraid of the unknown. But then one day, when the wind comes up, you magically let go and you soar into the air. The universe, the creator, supports you just like the red-tailed hawk. tell kids that when you see a red-tailed hawk being chased by small birds, think of it as a lesson. They're telling us when other people say mean and ugly things to us, like, you're not good enough, you can't do that. Remember, their words aren't true unless we believe them. So don't let people with small minds try to tear you down. Fly higher like the hawk.